Welcome back, data enthusiasts. In today's tutorial, we'll dive into the world of data processing and explore how to deploy a Spark cluster on Kubernetes. By the end of the video, you'll have the knowledge and the skills to harness and power these two technologies together. So let's get started. Before we begin, let's quickly go over the basics. Spark is a powerful open source data processing engine that allows you to analyze, process, and extract insights from massive datasets. On the other hand, Kubernetes is a container orchestration platform that simplifies management and scaling of applications. Combining Spark and Kubernetes offers a multitude of benefits. It allows you to effortlessly scale your Spark cluster, optimize resource utilization, and achieve cost efficiency. By leveraging the strengths of both technologies, you'll unlock new possibilities for efficient data processing. Now, let's explore the advantages of deploying Spark on Kubernetes. One of the key benefits is scalability. With Kubernetes, you can easily scale your Spark cluster up or down based on the workload demands, ensuring optimal resource allocation and cost effectiveness. Furthermore, deploying Spark on Kubernetes simplifies cluster management. You can seamlessly handle updates, monitor resources, and even automate tasks, saving you valuable time and effort. But perhaps the most compelling benefit is the ability to dynamically allocate resources. Kubernetes intelligently distributes resources across your Spark applications, ensuring efficient utilization and maximizing performance. So, step one, prepare your Kubernetes cluster by configuring the necessary settings. This includes defining resource limits, setting up network policies, and specifying any additional requirements for your deployment. So step one is installing Kubernetes and getting it set up and ready. I'm not going to go through that in great detail because there's plenty of places online where you can find tutorials to get your stuff set up. I'll just take you through what I've got here. So I'm running a K3s cluster on Scaleway, which is a cloud host in Europe. And so I have, as you can see here in K9s, I've got six nodes, and they are of different sizes. So I've got three that are smaller ones. I've got, I think, 4 cores and 8 gigs of RAM. And then I've got three that 8 cores and 32 gigs of RAM. And the reason I've done this is because I want to have three nodes that just do serving of web apps, running Jupyter notebooks and lightweight stuff. And then I wanted to have three nodes that are dedicated to running Spark. And the way that you can do that, if I just show you one of these Spark nodes, is inside of the labels, I've labeled them as Spark equals true. And we'll get on to what this means later when I show you the Helm chart install. But basically, Spark equals true for a label. And then down the bottom, where I can find it. Yeah. And then we've got taints. And I've tainted this with app equals Spark, no schedule, which again, we'll get into what that means. But basically, what I'm trying to do is ensure that only the Spark jobs get deployed onto the Spark nodes so that I don't have pods that aren't Spark related co-located with the Spark data processing stuff, just to keep it a little bit cleaner and easier to manage. Step two, deploy the Spark operator onto your Kubernetes cluster. The operator will act as a bridge between Spark and Kubernetes, enabling seamless integration and management. Okay, so installing the operator. Basically, what we want to do is install a pod into the Kubernetes cluster that runs and manages the Spark instances. Once that's installed, we'll also spin up a few Spark nodes to run alongside it. And so this should give us a working Spark cluster to then chuck a Spark job at. How am I going to do that? And the way that I want to do this is manage it using some Helm charts. Now, you can install these individually, or you can create a sort of master chart like I've done here that then manages all the subcharts that go with it. And so what I've got is a stripped out version of something I've been working on just to demonstrate how it's going to work. And then we'll have a look at one that's been installed using the same technique. So in here, we've got dependencies on Spark. Now, I don't know if anyone's come across the Bitnami charts, but they have some very well-designed Helm charts for different stuff. And so we're using their chart for Spark. Spark major version at the moment is 3.5. So you can see how the Spark Helm chart version doesn't mimic the application version, but that's fine. So we're on 7.1.1 of the Spark chart. I also want Kafka to be able to stream data into Spark. So again, Bitnami charts have a Kafka Helm chart that works really well. So again, we're on 23.0.4. And the last one, because I want to be able to demonstrate this visually for you all, is JupyterHub. Now, most of you will probably have come across JupyterHub. Basically, it allows me to run notebooks. And what I want to be able to do is run this whole thing like self-contained inside of the Kubernetes cluster so that you can see how I don't need to like run crazy port forwarding or anything like that. The whole routing will be done internally outside of course getting the UI for the Jupyter notebook. So that's also in the chart itself. Then we'll have a quick look at some of the values because I want to just walk you through how that works. Kafka, I have defined some storage, 100 gigs for no reason. So we've got persistence for Kafka. That's the only change I've made there. So we have a few changes on JupyterHub. We've got an admin user and a password just for us to be able to log in using a simple username and password authentication mechanism. Then we used single user pod configuration. Again, we have 100 gigs of storage, which just gives us a bit more wiggle room when I'm doing stuff on that cluster. And then we've got a network policy enabled false. Now, one thing I'll have a look at the end of this is firewall rules inside Kubernetes. And this one completely messed me up for a while because it blocked all incoming external HTTP requests. And so network policy enabled false is clearly a sledgehammer to fix this problem. for my use case, it was fine. Then we have a custom Jupyter pod with some different tooling and stuff on. So I pull that in and then I flip out the proxy because K3s wants to be able to deploy its own load balancer stuff. And this was just the easiest way I could figure out how to do it. Then obviously down into the crux of this tutorial, down here, we've got the Spark distribution itself. And so we define Spark. And then the way that I wanted to set this up, as I explained earlier, is to allow for certain pods to exist on certain nodes and nowhere else. And so we have a toleration here that says when the key app equals Spark, then no schedule, which means that toleration has to exist for both a master pod and a worker pods. It basically just forces them over onto a specific set of nodes. And then also the node affinity preset. Now, I didn't have this set at the start, and then I realized as my Spark workers fell over at some point, they regenerated themselves on the same instance. And so when you're telling it that it's got 30 gigs of RAM to work with and the machine has 32 gigs of RAM, and then you've got two workers on the same box, you quickly run into a sizing issue where they end up competing for the same resource and then knocking each other over. And it just becomes a never ending cycle of falling over pods. And so the node of preset just means that they won't then schedule themselves on the same node twice. And that is, you can have like soft and hard affinity. And this one is very much hard because I just don't want them on the same node twice. So lastly, with this Helm chart, of course, we need to install it. I won't go through the installation, but I will show you roughly what you do. So a Helm, and then I specify a namespace and then upgrade -install, which just means if it's not installed, go ahead and install it. Just saves you swapping commands out. We pass in the values file we were just looking at, and then I've named this one RCA, and it's in the local directory. So there's a little period at the end of it. When you hit the go button, that will install the stuff we've just been looking at, and then it looks something a bit like this. And so you can see at the bottom of the page, there are three Spark workers all scheduled on different nodes. There's then one Spark master. And of course, there's only three nodes, so Spark master coexists with one of the workers, but they go on to specific nodes that are Spark only, and you won't find other stuff then deployed onto that same node group. Further up, you can see there's a Kafka node, and there is also a hub, which is Jupyter's hub control plane. And when a user logs in, it starts a different pod with their own workspace stuff in it. So that's all nicely segmented, and we'll move on to the next step. Step three, create your Spark application specific file, which outlines the specific requirements and configurations for your Spark job. This will define the number of workers, memory allocations, and other application specific settings. We've got the Helm chart installed. Everything's up and running. Next thing I wanted to do was show you a sort of simple way of running a Spark job on your cluster from within your cluster. Now, of course, you can submit jobs from outside the cluster. External service can post stuff if you expose the service via a load balancer. Just running stuff within the cluster just makes life quite easy. So we'll just walk through this notebook quickly just to show you how it works. So we've got a few imports. We're going to be using PySpark. Of course, this would also work using Scala. But we're going to build a Spark session, and then we want to allocate 30 gigs of memory because I copied this from somewhere else. We want to define the shuffle partitions. All of this is optional. Otherwise, it falls back to defaults, which is usually okay for just test jobs. I want to enable spill to disk just because. This is where it gets a little bit interesting. So your Spark driver host. Now, I created a service that loops back to Jupyter because it needed to see the, it needed to have network access back to this execution engine. And so I created like a loopback headless service that just writes stuff back to the host. So this is Spark driver service jupe. And then the way that DNS works inside of a Kubernetes cluster is you have the namespace and then service.cluster.local. And so we know we're in the RCA namespace, and we've got a service called Spark driver service jupe. And then we also obviously have to specify the master. And so this is a service called RCA Spark Master 0, RCA Spark Headless. So I'm defining which master I want to come through, and then the service, and then again, the namespace and service.cluster.local, and then of course a port so that it can get access to it. Then step four, submit your Spark application to the Kubernetes cluster using Spark submit command. Sit back and watch as Kubernetes efficiently launches and manages your Spark job. So we've run the imports. Now we're going to execute the actual Spark session itself and then run a simple Spark job through it. So I'll go ahead and run this Spark session builder function. Now, do be aware that even though it may execute successfully, it's not actually going to run anything against that Spark cluster. So you might find when you go and run tasks against it that you then hit issues. It's often better if you're just getting stuff going to just start simply. And so in this case, where they're going to run this very simple data frame that sums 1 plus 1, basically. So that's going to run. You can then see it running against the Spark cluster, returning the value that you would expect it to return. So we know and we validated that your Spark job has just gone and run against Spark cluster inside of your Kubernetes cluster, which is pretty cool. And obviously that's where we want to be. While deploying Spark on Kubernetes offers numerous advantages, you may encounter some common issues along the way. So let's address a few and provide practical solutions. So issue number one, insufficient resources. If you notice your Spark job struggling with resource limitations, maybe it doesn't start, maybe it hangs, consider adjusting the resource requests and the limits in your Spark application specific file. Let's have a look at how we do that. So I'm going to try and demonstrate insufficient resource, which should be a pretty obvious one to be able to fix. If I restart this kernel, we know that each of the executors lives on a node that's got 38 gigs of RAM, 32 gigs of RAM or whatever it's got. So I'm going to up that and say, I want to allocate for my job 50 gigs of RAM. So this shouldn't get provisioned on the cluster now. So if I run that and run the Spark session builder, like I said, it will run successfully. Like it started this Spark session gateway up, but when I come to actually run it, should find that it never actually gets provisioned and it will just sit here and hang. So you can go into the Spark console at this point, you can port forward it, or you can hit it up via the API. And you can see here that the initial job has not accepted any resources because it hasn't got a node that's got 50 gigs of spare memory to allocate to this resource. You can leave this running. And then if you went and allocated the node that did have 50 gigs of spare RAM available, it would then go and just start up. It'll sit here indefinitely, but it won't ever actually provision. And you've got the same problem with cores and other aspects of Spark job management. This is troubleshooting tip number one to bear in mind. Issue number two, networking complications. In some cases, network policies or firewalls may hinder communications between Spark and Kubernetes. This can happen at cluster level. Ensure that necessary network configurations are in place and consult your network administrator if needed. Of course, you may need access to resource that isn't in your Kubernetes cluster, or there's firewall policies in your Kubernetes cluster that affect things running at pod level. So just be aware of the nuances there. So I just wanted to give you also an example of networking issues that you might hit. Like I said, there's a multitude of different networking issues, from external access, internal access, firewalls, all that type of stuff. But one that I hit, and I alluded to it earlier, at the Spark driver host, I had to create this service so that the Spark worker could link back to the place that the job was being executed from. And so I created this service and I just wanted to show you roughly what it looked like. So this gets deployed along with the rest of the Helm chart stuff. You can see it's Spark driver service. There is no cluster IP. I just wanted to be a headless service. And I have a selector that allows me to select pod, because I know there's only going to be one of them. Select pod that the service loops back to. And so that gives me networking access back without having to deal with IP addressing or crazy DNS and all that type of stuff. So this service is one example of how networking issues can be resolved using Kubernetes DNS resolution and some headless service to fix that problem. Remember, troubleshooting is part of the process. By understanding and addressing these challenges, you'll become a more proficient Spark and Kubernetes user. Congratulations, you've successfully learned how to deploy a Spark cluster on Kubernetes. Now take a moment to reflect the enormous potential and efficiency these technologies offer. If you're hungry for more knowledge, make sure to explore our documentation, tutorials, blog posts, and other resources that are available on the internet for you. We're dedicated at Spicule to helping you unlock the true power of data processing and provide you with the best resources to succeed. Thank you for joining us today. If you found the tutorial helpful, don't forget to subscribe or follow us to stay up to date with the latest insights and tutorials. Together, let's unleash the true potential of data processing with Spark and Kubernetes. Until next time, happy data processing. Brought to you by Spicule Limited, trusted data scientists, software engineers, IT professionals, and DevOps engineers. Our expertise and experience makes us your go-to partner in the world of data processing.